World Championship Finals. SK Telecom T1 still writing their undefeated story as we get into the first game of finals, and they played immaculate that game, falling behind only for a few minutes in the early game.
There was some risk in the pick and ban phase we saw from them, the Kassadin pick in the mid lane. Obviously, it's a very good matchup into the Lulu, and that's what Faker used so effectively. But also Wolf, we didn't talk too much about him on this Shen. He was part of 95% of the kills SKT had. He was just everywhere on the map. He was joining in whenever they needed him, whenever they set up 2v1s or 3v1s even.
And every time you pick Kassadin, you are picking into an inherent amount of risk because you're leaving yourself a little open to map pressure. But we've also seen the emergence of support Shen specifically for LCK teams, and Wolf's ability to kind of feel like he was everywhere at once did a lot to keep Ku Tigers pushed back in the game. And then looking at his scoreline, he really was everywhere that mattered at the right time.
Well, Wolf currently 3-0 on that Shen. Shen now 10-1, so he had a good hand in making a nice record for the Ninja here coming into the tournament, and they used it very well, especially with, as we talking about Faker's Kassadin on Ignite. More kill pressure to his lane, but always being in the right spot at the right time when Ku's teleports were up.
Yeah, we didn't see him get a kill one versus one, but it's enough to have the threat that, hey, I can kill you. So Lulu has to sit far back and then catch the wave pretty late, and then Kassadin can leave the lane. That's what we saw again and again. Pick and ban phase now, though. Obviously, teams are going to swap. Ku Tigers on blue side. It should mean SKT just want to focus on the standard Gangplank, Mordekaiser, and then probably Elise. Should set it fairly simple for Ku Tigers, then, okay, what's the plan? Make sure you don't trade one for two when it comes to all the strong picks like Kalista and Tahm Kench and so on.
Well, Ku is one of those teams that knows what happens when you leave GP open, mainly against the Flash Wolves. Wasn't a very good game for them, so I don't think that GP will ever be left open again. And you're right, they're on blue side now, so changes will be made.
I think there's a very high chance we see a first pick Tahm Kench if it's not banned away by SKT. It's something they've really wanted to do. Gorilla was pretty much the first person to play the best Tahm Kench here at Worlds.
Yeah.
One of the best Tahm Kench games was from Gorilla. And yeah, the fact that they haven't banned it speaks pretty highly to the chance they're going to first pick it.
Also, Wolf showing one of his first plays on Tahm Kench against AHQ. That dive under the turret on An was absolutely ridiculous.
They're both fantastic players.
Showing the prowess of what he could do as well. So I can't wait to see if Kench does get unbanned.
And that's the problem for SKT. Because again, you normally look at Gangplank, Mordekaiser, and Elise as like the three bans.
Whoa, who banned it?
Very surprised. Yeah. I would have first picked this, even given a Rek'Sai, and just take Elise in again. For Hojin, he had a fine performance on this in the early game. If that was going to be the strategy for Ku Tigers, we're expecting Elise to be banned.
Yeah, because now this can create the exact same type of Lulu or Rek'Sai choice that SKT opted into in game one. Yeah, now it will be Ku getting the Rek'Sai. And we do have to wonder if SKT is going to go with Lulu. They're so good at it, normally.
Exactly the same.
It's not in their head, Jap.
I dislike the fact that Ku Tigers did the Tahm Kench here. However, if they leave Tahm Kench, they get one, SKT gets two. At this point, when you're trading these bans, it can get a little bit dicey.
That's right. I mean, if I was Ku Tigers, I would have banned Lulu as my last ban instead.
Absolutely.
And then looked at SKT and said, okay, if you want to ban Elise, we take Tahm Kench, you get Rek'Sai. That's an okay trade. Obviously, it meant SKT could possibly leave both junglers open. It was like Tahm Kench for Elise.
Which I think is fine.
Which I still think you could have done if you are the Ku Tigers, or at least you get the Elise pick then for Hojin, his best early game jungler. So a little bit surprised about it from the Ku Tigers. SKT will now be able to do the same kind of comp. Protect the AD carry if they want to.
You're looking at an undefeated Elise on both sides. Six plays in for Bangi, five in for Hojin. So nobody wants to leave that up on either side and
get the
spider in the game. Fiora will be picked up by Smeb in the top lane. We usually see Marin taking that out of the rift, but Kuro has had a few chances as well.
Yeah, well, especially after he played it all four games against KT, continued to have good performances with it against Fnatic. It was a little bit strange that it wasn't picked nor banned in the first game. So Ku Tigers kind of going back to that Fiora well, hoping that Smeb can carry the game.
I think the reason Ku Tigers didn't want to play it last game, obviously Rumble was picked, they wanted the Riven matchup into it, but also because Shen was in the game on the side of SK Telecom. So it was going to be very difficult to beat that split pusher. Riven can go in and flank a teamfight and kind of burst down one target more and have some AoE at least, where the Fiora does not, very single target focused. Now, because Alistar goes in as the second support, when once Tahm Kench is gone, people go Alistar very often.
Right.
Shen was available for Ku Tigers. They could run the Fiora. They will have this insane split push now with Smeb and double global for both jungle pick and support pick. Ku Tigers should be able to set up a very good split pushing scenario here for Smeb.
SKT throwing together a little AoE in their composition with Rumble again for Marin. Bang will pick up Jarvan for Bengi in the jungle.
Well, this, I think, will be extremely interesting. Marin was free to pick the Rumble into Smeb's Fiora last game, and then Ku opted for a different matchup. Yeah. I think Marin is very confident in Rumble against Fiora. We've been waiting for people to kind of find the right Fiora counterpick. Was it Darius? Well, no, that kind of fell apart. It was Renekton in some games, unless you built in an extremely proper way and had your whole team helping you. Now I think we're going to get to see the best kind of anti-Fiora matchup possible. We thought maybe it would be Lissandra.
We were hoping at least.
Big picks, but maybe it's going to be the Rumble. We're going to have to see how this matchup plays out.
At least Rumble can be very difficult to dive in the early game. Often what happens if you're losing the lane, you get pushed into a tower, jungler shows up. Rumble ulti and his tankiness makes it difficult at least to kill him. What are we looking at here?
Support Shen, top Fiora,
AD carry Shen.
Kennen.
Oh, sorry, AD carry Kennen. AD carry Shen.
You had the ninja.
AD carry Kennen.
No, I love this. This is pretty much comfort zone for everyone on Ku, except you could say Prey because he hasn't competitively played Kennen AD carry. Mm-hmm. But specifically, when they were preparing for Fnatic, he prepared this as a pick to go against Reckless, who was playing so much AD Kennen in case they'd have to take it away.
Yeah.
So he's very practiced on this AD Kennen at this point.
And Kennen is very good into a lot of these hyper carries because, first of all, he has a fine laning phase against him. Once he gets a Cutlass and the Blade of the Ruined King, he's very strong 1v1. So this AD carry cannot sit on his own in the side lane and risk taking a duel with the Kennen. They can try and farm out. That's why Tristana also comes in here for Bang. It's one of the safer AD carries at sitting and farming up in the side lane. But really, Ku Tigers are building for a 1-3-1 setup. Insane split push coming from Smeb with Rek'Sai and Shen joining him. Wave clear in the mid lane from the Victor. Very standard Ku Tigers composition from what we've seen here at Worlds. And SKT obviously saying, well, let's go team fight. Hard engage Jarvan, we're gonna take the fights.
In this case, I do like the amount of AoE damage and crowd control the Ku can put together, because typically teams that have Lulu in the mid lane do tend to group up in fairly small balls of people. So therefore, the AoE from Ku Tigers will be able to hit SKT a little bit harder. It'll be very interesting, though, to see how this mid lane matchup goes, because both guys have opted into Ignite.
Yeah, we're going to fight in this mid lane here. Koro saying, you
sure
know what?
I hope so.
My teleport didn't work last time. I'm going to try now and duel this Lulu. If I can push in Faker, suddenly he can be the guy roaming and assisting the lanes like Faker did in the last game.
Been a quiet mid lane for this Worlds tournament. Usually you hear the top laners are on an island, but the mid laners have been very soft in their back and forth. A few times for Faker, a few other solos throughout the tournament, but more than not, like we said, Faker, not really a playmaker this time. It's more about the rest of the team. We'll see if that turns tides here with Ignite in the mid lane. Keep updating your Twitter votes throughout this series. Send that hashtag KOOWin or hashtag SKTWin to @LOLESports, and we can see how you are calling this as we get on to the Rift. Game two of this best of five here in Berlin at the World Championship Finals. SKT two games away, from the Summoner's Cup, hoisting it once again. It will be the only team to have those two wins at Worlds.
There were no huge surprises in game one, aside from the fact that SKT played around Cassidy incredibly well. Ku Tigers wasn't really able to do anything with the minor advantages they had gained in the early game. Because remember, first game, SKT played a very defensive early game strategy, did not get any deep wards, and were vulnerable to a little bit of a Ku Tigers counter invade later into the game, where they outnumbered the number of jungle camps that SKT could take and gained a very early experience advantage. Ku does need to jump on SKT early because they were able to do it in game one.
And Origin last week were supposed to be the guys who could maybe create an upset, take a game against SK Telecom. They did really well in game one. Ku Tigers had a good early game at least, but then we saw it fall apart. I wonder when you face a team like SK Telecom and you're mentally trying to be so ready and say, this way I'm gonna play the best game of my life. I'm gonna take down SKT, I'm gonna take down Faker, take the trophy, run away with it. He's not gonna get his hands on it. And then you lose that first game. It is so hard to then rebound into game two because like you just had everything invested into one game. It didn't work for you. Origin, I feel like, had the same problem. We're going to have to see if Ku Tigers can show up in game two.
That's the thing about SKT is you can take them down in every facet, but if you haven't chipped away at their mentality, they are still very much so in the game.
Yeah, and we've been talking a lot about like what will it take for SKT to lose a game? Because SKT is so fluid and reactive, and we got to talking and we're saying like, oh, SKT, they just do things by the book. But then the question is like, what book? What book are you doing that tells you how to play this perfect League of Legends? Because what they're able to do is make the right play across the board, which is so fascinating and so difficult to do in League of Legends because you are five individuals trying to play as one. And that's really what makes SK Telecom so far this year at Worlds, is their ability to play as an absolute team.
Yeah, and that's really the scary thing. A team with so many carry players, insane mechanics, top lane, AD carry, mid lane as well. And when you then add in what I feel is the best shot calling we see from a team in League of Legends, and really the main thing players can tell us how quick they can make these decisions, reading, okay, Mini Wave is pushing one lane, so we need to defend there, move down, and then keep always rotating around.
Right, and Wolf successfully pushes them off of Booba, which is, again, kind of a smart play, and do they see a big opportunity? Because normally Ku should funnel to Raptors. Now Marn's there.
Marn charging the Flamesplitter. He came in with his gauge over half.
Oh, and
a level one turret dive! Bengi definitely messed that up! Can they get Smith? Marn's gonna go down here too! SKT go way too hard in the early game!
This is what they call the caster curse. You talk about it.
Play by the book, Jen.
Play it by the book. Capitalize on opponent missteps. Never overstep your bounds. I was just going to say SKT has been the perfect low-risk, medium-reward team. But by double flashing into the turret at 2.5 minutes, that was a high-risk, low-to-medium-reward play. SKT completely out of character. And Ku Tigers get 2 kills in the early game.
They were in such a good position. Just push these guys out of the jungle, force them to recall. You're now way ahead in the lane swap. Go up, take your tower. Marin now.
It snowballs because they do not have the support from the others.
This is exactly what we didn't see last game. These turrets were being pushed by only members of the opposite
Bengi's
team.
There too now.
Now SKT tries to defend that turret.
They're waiting for Shen Kong.
Cost them their life. 2 lives to go down. Now Bengi just came back from being dead. It's going to be a real long walk to get back into his jungle. Great turret aggro trading. And that's Gorilla coming in for the final kill. One last shot. He's still alive.
Oh.
It's a third shot that will take him down. He gets caught up in his own minions.
Even so, things have gone from bad to worse, and that is the collateral damage or just the extended loss of what SKT did in the jungle of Ku Tigers. They completely fell apart for about a minute and a half. Let's see if they can recover.
If Ku Tigers didn't feel confident going into game two, they do now. 4 kills, 4 minutes in, and such a greedy play just from SKT, sending Marn down with no flash to sit in this bottom lane.
Yeah.
Bengi didn't go anywhere on the map either. He had to go top and dive Smep like we saw Hojin do right here. Or he had to just try and farm it up, but that would mean his top laner could die. Going down to defend him this late would never really do anything. And Ku Tigers just a step ahead of SKT, punish him in this lane swap completely. Smep is level 3, 16 CS, he's gonna be more than fine now.
Yeah, and maybe if SKT could have had both Bengi and Marin under the turret at the same time,
yes,
but even that's a little bit dangerous because they're both down flashes from the earlier play. Really, just a series of errors by SKT that were capitalized on by Ku by doing that turret dive. Now the question will be, where does Ku go from here? Because they haven't been able to push their advantages extremely well, except in the group stages, actually,
yeah,
when they're able to do it against CLG repetitively.
Well, already an uncharacteristic game for Ku here. Who usually we say Hojin sits back, waits for the counter. They were so proactive in those engages. I don't think they're going to be stopping anytime soon, but definitely need to focus that Hojin giving the kills to his lanes now. He's 2-0-2, doesn't need too much more as an early game jungler. We'll see if he can help the other members get going on the team. Gorilla heading back down towards the bottom lane. They're looking to make some plays, trade that damage. They know these little upper hands in the lane are really going
nice
to
done.
Go far throughout the game. Wolf, level 2, his flash is still down. He's going to be forced to just do some triumphant roars if he's even leveled it here.
Ku Tigers keep playing around the lanes where SKT has no flashes from that level 1.
Right.
Marin still missing his flash. Wolf, of course, missing his flash. So they knew, okay, they're overextending on the bottom side. Make a play, but right now Smep is just sitting on his own on top lane. He's getting solo experience. He's more than fine again.
And this would actually be the book that you play by if you're Ku Tigers. You see a small hole in the opponent armor. You hit it again and again and again until those flashes are up again. They're completely happy with Smep farming, and they know if they continue to hit SKT's weak spot, SKT will continue to send defenses down there, which means they won't be stopping Smeb on the other side either. So things going very well for Ku Tigers.
Assistance ping called in by Hojin here. It looks like they want to make a move in towards the jungle. Wolf Spirit did move, but Faker, I don't think, caught that. He'll still be safe to get out of this. But this is the first action we've seen towards mid lane. Faker and Kuro are probably like, what is going on around us right now?
Well, Faker's happy in the lane so far. He's winning quite easily. I didn't see if Kuro had to leave the mid lane, maybe to try and rush down and be part of this tower dive, even though he never got any assist, so he's not really been able to add any value there. But it does obviously mess a little bit with you as a player. You suddenly have to leave at level 1 to join a weird fight behind you. It can set you behind. I think that's what happened in this mid lane. It is still fairly even.
Even though I actually think it was Faker that pushed up a little bit into the turret as well, so maybe a few CS lost early by Kuro. I will say, though, Kuro, even when they're in large deficits, has always been able to have massive impact in teamfights on Victor. I think it's really excited to see how he can deal against Faker's Lulu, who's very high pressure mid laner, trying to roam. And Victor's, I think, a pretty good pick against that because he can counter shove the lane very easily after Lulu does that and kind of match the roams.
And as you mentioned earlier yourself, when you're against the Lulu, you don't want too much single target damage because she's going to shield that guy, block him up with ulti. You want massive AoE. Victor will offer that. Smith, nice little play here, can riposte the damage coming in from Bang.
And in that melee, Kuro knows exactly what he's doing. 8-2 over the summer split with an 8.5 KDA on Victor.
Victor was his pick.
Yes.
He brought it into the meta and it started the spring split. And then everyone was like, oh, Victor, he's extremely strong. Let's all start playing him. And we still play him half a year later.
We'll see what he can continue to do. Like we said, no, not much action to the mid lane. Everybody else getting themselves going. Hojin still 2-0-2 as things have kind of slowed down. A little breather for both teams as they get full three levels under the turret. They have all the skills to get out or get in if necessary. Hojin, Ku actually got some nice deep wards that have already been cleared out so far. So we'll see if they can get themselves back into that jungle and ward it up.
I would have liked to see SKT say, you know what, guys, we've been losing now this one-on-one between obviously the top laner's order, AD carry versus the top laner. And our own top laner, the Rumble, is sitting and having to share experience with our support.
Yeah,
he's really far behind. It's gonna be a tough dive for Bengi.
Yeah, sub-level 6, Jarvan. Riposte will be up very shortly for Smeb, but they're going anyways.
Goes back towards the turret, trying to keep himself in between the wall. That's the flash out. Can't get the grand challenge onto Bang. Smeb will not go down from that, I don't think. Should stay alive. He has just a sliver of health. This has to be going back.
Oh!
He misses the strike, but he does get the auto as Smeb flashes in range, unfortunately. Those are some fast fingers you got to play to get out of that situation. I think SKT had it either way. Flash for flash, though, as the kill goes down.
SKT clearly said, okay, Bang, keep pushing the lane. You might be able to get a tower. Then we will swap the lanes back. Rumble should recall from this bottom side once Tristana appears in the lane. Get him into that one-on-one against Vero so he gets some experience. But I feel it's almost too late for Morin. He's falling almost too far behind in experience. It's very important they got that one kill at least. That was all they were keeping Bang for. To keep pushing in the lane, try and get a tower. He didn't get it though, because they took the kill instead.
Smeb's been doing a very nice job on Bang, getting that damage down, pushing him off the waves, not allowing it to always be at the turret. Definitely saved his life for a little bit longer than necessary there. Did see him go down, blow his flash, but he is coming back with a Tiamat, so that's only going to get easier for him to farm that lane out and be somewhere else for his team when necessary.
Absolutely, and Smeb with the two deaths as well. It's actually not too out of character for what Ku has been doing so far at Worlds. He actually has given up more First Bloods than any other player at Worlds. So he does die early in lane somewhat frequently with the aggressiveness in which he plays. That time, he had been poked down pretty low by Tristana. He thought he could outplay the dive. He has a lot of confidence in his ability to outplay because more often than not, especially in teamfights, he does. But this time it cost him.
Good play though from SKT in the end. Kind of saving Morin here. He was falling really far behind in experience early on. Full level is a lot when it comes to these 1v1s, especially when one of them is a Fiora who needs to get punished in the early game, otherwise she will outscale you. Going in on Morin now. He has flash ready.
Morin throws down the equalizer. That does not look like a good situation for him, though. Very nice
Kuro
over the wall. He's got full vision here, but he doesn't have vision behind Baron. Instantly lasered down by Kuro, and his Victor just gets a kill. He just walked up lane and got it. Faker's still farming there, and he's not going to lose any minions as he comes back.
Wow, and a small interaction there. Wolf actually gives Gorilla a gift because the Shen ult was coming in, but Wolf interrupted him, so now they get to keep the 2v2 as well. They get the global presence from the Shen shield during their dive, and they don't lose the map pressure for it either.
Same thing as we saw in the last game against the Lulu. You push her into this tower, she stays there, she tries to farm it up, push it back, and then you roam to the other lanes. Bengi, gonna find Smith now. There's ulti on this Jarvan, so you can lock him down at least.
A lot of love from Bengi on this meddling. Cataclysm down. Flame Spitter should be able to take Smeb out quite quickly.
There's Hojin.
Oh, the kill, though. Smeb. He makes it. Grand Challenge is down, so this is all about Smeb's abilities. Flame Spitter finishes him off, but Marin is overheated as he makes his way out now with the Scrap Shield. He should be okay. This is Kuro's second roam. That means his mid is open, but it pays off with kill number two.
Kuro has been out roaming Faker this game, and Smeb comes up huge with that play. But everything happens up top, means time to fight down bottom.
Once SKT sees an opening, they take it. That's Unbreakable Will on. Slicing Maelstrom's gonna put a bit of crowd control. They need to stop Bang from dishing out the DPS. But it looks like they won that trade nicely. They'll be able to sit back in lane as Wolf tries to heal it up.
SKT with their bottom lane here picked against the cannon, saying we have a headbutt, we have buster shot, we have so many ways of shooting you away from us when you pop that ulti. So it's going to be hard for Prey to kill this lane, but he's not here to kill the lane. He's right. here just to support the rest of the team in the fight, because right now, you have two kills on your top laner, he's been getting solo experience, and you just ganked the lane and got more kills for him.
Yeah, and I think this is another time to call attention to the itemization timings. Yep. Last game, Bengi was at 16 minutes before he completed Sightstorm. He had a Cinder Hulk, which gave him very good combat effectiveness. This time, Bengi has an early Sightstone, less combat effectiveness when he goes up to try and kill Smeb, weakens him enough for Smeb to be able to kill him, and is one of the major reasons Ku ended up winning that trade. Yep. Because SKT's been on the back foot, they're warding more, but it means Bengi can't actually take fights.
Oh, he knocks him up inside the gravity field. Flag and drag Mayland over the
laser.
Wall. Not much they can follow there. The flash is already down from Kuro. Does he want it? That gives him the speed! And he gets the last auto in for the third kill of the game.
Everything is going wrong for SKT right now. This is a play we normally don't see. Bengi walks into the enemy jungle to place a ward when his own mid lane is back in base. Faker wasn't even nearby, so he was all alone. Gets caught out. Faker now wants to kill Kuro.
Oh, what a turn.
Faker pressuring Kuro here. Flashes in, gets the kill. Looks like there was a little of bot lane as well, but they turned off of that. Faker getting it right back for himself.
I feel like Faker just completely turned this game, because it looked like Ku was making play after play and never breaking the momentum. The three-man gank that they were prepping bottom lane, I think absolutely could have worked, but yeah. The instant Faker kills Curl there, the entire team pulls off the gank. Alistar ultimate was still down, so they could have been able to focus him. At that point, Faker turns the kill around, gets the shutdown on Curl, knows that Curl used a lot of his summer spells and power to get the kill on Bengi, and it's the right time to go aggressive.
It's top lane, man. Smeb is just getting further and further ahead.
He's the one with the lead now.
Remember, SKT decided to put Marin down to the bottom lane. They decided to keep him there with the Alistar for such a long time, sharing experience. Replay from before. This is where it goes, you know, away from their by the book plays, because these are the kind of outplays a team like SKT can make.
This when is the choose your own adventure.
Right. When everything looks terrible, they're making some mistakes, they get one of these solo plays. Top lane, might see a dive though.
I think they saw a little bit too much behind Marin to really keep wanting that. Hojin in a bad, bad spot, and it looks like the team is going to leave him out to dry. That is not going to be good. Ku had that lead, and it is being squeezed smaller and smaller by SKT's moves.
Bang and Wolf were there when Ku did not expect them to be there.
Yes.
So that was just catching them off guard and in a bad timing right here. Kuro able to get the blue, which is actually pretty clutch, and this could end up being a trade of turrets.
Should do. This tower is so low on the top side, we know Prey can't join. Same with Faker though, he's also on the bottom lane.
Yeah, Kuro has moved to defend, so they're actually trying to save this turret as best as possible, and they pushed SKT off of it.
Teleport's going to be up for Marin, but his ultimate is following very slowly on that one. Hojin onto Bang. Bang jumps nicely over the wall, makes it to safety. Wolf's gonna headbutt himself a little bit further towards the turret. Looks like they could be safe here. That teleport's there for Marin, but he's gonna stay. The team calls safe. No problems from Ku here, as Ku again attempt to get themselves even farther ahead.
Yeah, well, they definitely repelled the pressure that was on their turret. Then they let it die to
yes.
minions because they were too aggressive there. So really unfortunate move there for Ku. But I really love the way Bang counterplayed that gank. He doesn't want to try and rocket jump over the Rek'Sai because the Rek'Sai will unburrow and interrupt the jump. So he was very patient with the way he used that to jump around. Marin takes a short cut, but it's not a good one.
Oh, Hojin over the wall. It's not even going to be necessary. He does get the assist, though, in the end. And that is going to be Kuro, 4-1-0 now.
Another really sloppy mistake here from SKT. Ku Tigers were just fighting on the top side of the map to walk into your jungle, and you didn't just walk straight through the mid lane and not really sure how Marin got caught out of position in the first place by moving up there. Ends up dying. Kuro's 4 kills now on this Victor. It's gonna be so key in the late game fights.
And this is the worst I've seen Marin play in Worlds. Early game, he flashes under the turret to try and get like a refund kill when it's definitely gonna be his death. And then again here in the mid lane with the fifth death.
Slicing Maelstrom, they are gonna call in the TP. Smab's in, is that a fight that they can take here? All Unbreakable Will is down, so it's definitely an option to go for Wolf. Marin's gonna join the fight, and he lays down the red carpet for Smab to enter, and it looks like Smab will go down as he hits the front door. Somehow, Wolf stays alive.
In the end, it's Ku Tigers investing a teleport to try and create a play where, honestly, they just want to have this one versus one in top lane. They don't need to try and join him for these fights. Just let Smeb do his job on his own. Because then SKT has to send up multiple guys to help Marin kill Smep, and that's where you get your openings.
Yeah, I agree, but when you're in a position to take down SK Telecom, what type of decisions will you make? Here, Ku does see a window because SKT burns Luluwald and an exhaust onto Prey early on, which means Smep thinks he's free to go in, but the matching teleport way in the back has Smep tunnel. He's out of mana by the time he goes in, so he can't dash to proc the last vital.
Oh.
I like the idea of putting the vitals on the Alistar because you're doing percent health true damage every time you proc the vital. Therefore, you can take down Alistar in an unbreakable will, but he was not respecting the teleport and absolutely should have disengaged.
Yeah, and that was the weird thing, not respecting the TP, and he was recalling top lane. He was like, okay, back to base, got a lot of gold probably. And then he's like, oh, I have to react now, try and help my AD carry down on the bottom side. Those kind of plays can cost Ku Tigers a lot, because now obviously setting up that split push is going to be more difficult with no flash for Fiora and no teleport for her. Might slow down the game a little bit for SKT, give them more chance to farm again. You still don't have really anything completed for your AD carry. Faker's been doing well in the mid lane, but he's obviously not going to be the main damage dealer on your team.
Looks like SKT still wants to make plays. Early distortion mobility for Wolf so he can get the flash pulverizes in to start things off. He does have that wild growth we just saw. Save his life if Unbreakable Will is down. A lot of options to go in. It's like Wolf and Bengi are going to be Bash Brothers here starting off these fights once they get the chance.
Yeah, typically though, because of the gold deficit, we have to see a much craftier SKT. They can't just make the brute force outnumber plays that they could last game when they had big advantages. Here, they have to be very creative, make Ku overcommit, and play from behind, which is what SKT has been able to do very well in the past, but they are in a much different position than in game one.
And Kuro really wants to have an impact right now, or keep his impact going, because he's obviously had a great start to the game. Morel Normicon, it means you can go for your magic penetration boots, so your mid-game damage is very, very high on the Victor. Obviously delays your late-game items a little bit, but he wants to fight at the moment. He wants to be able to one-shot someone from SKT.
I think that something that is very strange about this game is that we're 19 minutes in and the first dragon has not been taken. Ku Tigers has had what should be pretty good map control, but they have consistently been prepping turret dives and going for kills instead of securing the objective per se. Even with the global pressure of the Rek'Sai and the Shen, you'd think they would have gone for that already. But if we do see a big fight here, it would be around the Dragon Pit because that's what SKT is trying to draw in here with the mid-game Lulu Trist. This is super dangerous to Fischio.
This is so risky for SKT. There's two items already on Prey. He's joining in as well. If there's a fight, Ku Tigers should be able to win it.
Well, Gorilla was coming down like he wanted that fight.
Just gonna take mid tower instead.
Yeah, push mid.
Yeah, this is the counterplay right now. SKT may sacrifice mid lane, but if they can trade bottom turret for mid turret and get the dragon, it's a giant win for them right now. They're keeping bang bottom, and as long as they can defend team turret 2, this is a huge win for SKT.
Smep wanted to stay top lane and push it out, but again, he had no teleport. It was used in that fight earlier where he ends up dying, so he couldn't join in time. They're pushing the tower.
Because they see the Trist bottom, they wanted to push the inner middle turret right there, but you can really see that with the Lulu and the Rumble there, the turret push just isn't happening. Now Ku is trying to get deeper vision within the SKT jungle, but as you can see, SKT's really contesting almost everything.
This is where they're hoping Ku makes a mistake. A lot of damage onto Smet, but very nice parry on the flag and drag, and I don't know if they're going to be able to get the damage they want. Gorilla goes in the middle of the fight with a nice flash and
back,
no. Gorilla goes down. Here comes Kuro. Throws down the Chaos Storm. It's all over Wolf, though.
Oh!
Nice flash Faker's over side. The wall from Faker, and he glitter lances over the Krugs and gets away so he does not take too much damage. Somehow, every member of SKT is alive, but Ku is still on the chase. Marin dodging out the damage of the laser means there's not much follow-up to be had.
And this whole time, Bang is pushing the bottom tier turret. This is SKT winning all across the map.
SKT saw Ku Tiger split up and said, let's put down the Rumble ulti, let's try and lock down Fiora in the Rumble ulti. No flash for Smep to get out of it. That's how SKT starts the fight. And Prey, he left the bottom side to run all the way to top lane, try and join, didn't manage to, ends up losing another tower.
This is the craftiness that we were talking about with SKT, and one of the most underrated parts of Rumble Ultimate is the range in which you can use it. Look where Marin is right here when he decides to cut them off with Equalizer. He landed the second half and he completely cuts off the funnel. So when Bengi comes over the top, he does lock them within the Equalizer, not to mention the split up right there, and it's miraculous of SKT to have everyone survive throughout that fight.
Fantastic plays all around. They're able to take down Wolf here. This will help them get towards the turrets a little bit more, but you still have Faker, you still have Marin to clear the waves. What play from both teams so far? 10-9, still a slight gold lead by 1,000 in favor of KU, and it's not something, like we said, SKT has worked with very much, being down. They're usually the team up by at least 2,000 to 3,000 at this point.
Yeah, and that's why, again, it's so impressive how they can use every single advantage they find. Oh, okay, you just invested all your summoners as a top laner. We know we can engage on you now if there's an opening. We know there's no split pushing pressure because TP is down. So, like, it bought a lot of time for SKT to make some plays as a team, group together as five, out rotate the KU Tigers, and then pick the right team fights as well. Really well played, and KU Tigers are learning, okay, we cannot split up like this. We have to stay together because the engage from the Jarvan and the hard engage option he brings is too high for us to split up. Because we have so many squishy members. I mean, the only real tank on this team is gonna be Hojin sitting in the front. Shen is not gonna be tank enough as a support to really stay in the front line.
I think it's gonna be a huge balance though, because Smeb needs to be able to split push, and they need to be able to disengage some of these team fights. That's the whole reason he's picking the Fjord. But SKT brings some friends.
Grand challenge in, cannot get the last hit. Gorilla way too deep here. Use Stand United to get on Smeb, but Smeb turned from the fight immediately. He's trying to get the hits on a Bang. That's going to be the explosive shot, taking him down. Bang knew he could get the kill easily. SKT working well within their champion's capabilities here.
You said to yourself here before, Jad, SKT, or KU Tigers, sorry, have to be able to split push. They had used another teleport from Smeb to get one kill on Wolf in the mid lane. So once again, that global is gone. They're not using this Fiora at all. Keep burning the teleports for absolutely nothing. This one obviously was just Bang. Returning to the bot side, really, really smart decision from him, ends up getting a 2-0 trade.
And the trouble here for KU is it's also so hard for Smeb to exist well in team fights. Lulu, Polymorph, also slow and somewhat reliable damage from SKT, does not get parried well. One of the biggest things about Smeb in their semifinal against Fnatic is he was parrying or riposting giant CCs, Skarner Ultimate, Riven stuns, huge bursts of damage. But that isn't the way SKT's composition is built. It's sustained damage over time and good crowd control. So really, Smeb needs to be smarter about these split pushes because SKT is consistently outwitting him. He can win the 1v1 against Rubble, but he's overcommitted.
We've also seen it's very hard for Smeb to hit all of the vitals with the amount of pop-ups, the flag and drag Bengi used twice in the last fight to stay away from those vitals and get Smeb his HP back on Grand Challenge. A lot of things work against KU Tigers in these fights.
One of the reasons Lulu has been seen as one of these really, really power picks in this meta is because she works so well against all these top lane carries. Like, oh, you want to single down one guy with your Fiora ulti, he has everything invested from Lulu to save that guy. Whimsy comes in against like Darius, you can just kite him for days. She works extremely well against all the top lane carries. So SKT were happy enough taking that in that rotation, where KU Tigers said that apparently they were fine giving more of a protect the AD carry comp to SKT. And I still think it was okay for KU. They just haven't been able, once again, to use their lead properly. They keep making these small mistakes on the map, how they want to use the globals, when do they want to assert pressure on one side, and that's what SKT is punishing every single time.
SKT working very well proactively throughout the tournament, always waiting for a team to make mistakes. Marin's going to have to respect this push towards the top side, but they're calling up Bang as well. This actually may be a fight. Smeb pushed up very far here, but he does have some friends in the river that could head up.
Very creative what they're doing right here. They're keeping Lulu as the wave pusher. They're actually not playing three lanes right here like they usually do because they are consistently trying to lay traps for Smeb, hoping he goes for kills on Marin, and then turning. How often do you see an AD carry waiting for a counter gank? Second time for SKT.
Smeb lunged to get away. Looks like it will be enough of the distance to get out of any danger. That dragon is alive, though. We've only seen one on the map now. 26 minutes in, could be dragon number two. It's both teams kind of hold hands as they make their way down the river. Get that vision.
If SKT starts the dragon instantly, if they know the exact time of teleport, they will get a 5v4, but then they will lose top tower. So I think it's better to send Marin back to this tower, push out the wave, and then look for KU Tigers to make a move before you decide to do anything. And that's exactly what they're doing now. Just don't early TP down and like just 5-man the dragon. Wait to see the play happening, and this is what's going to happen for KU Tigers.
Really good Zhonya's.
Drill that'll pierce the heavens. Can Marin do it? A 4v1 situation. It looks like he will go down as all five members of Kuu are towards the top side. That's going to mean Dragon, and they don't really have a wave to get a push on.
That was a very greedy play by Marin to be under the turret, but at the same time, SKT is going to try and make that work with committing the four-man dive. What will SKT get out of that? They actually defended the turret, traded his life for the Dragon, and a mid-inner.
This is one of the reasons SKT wants to play Rumble against teams who can split push against him, because on the turret, he can do so much damage before he goes down. He always builds Hourglass early as well, which delays him going down. So even with it was greedy for Marin to get under that tower, it bought enough time for SKT to take two objectives, a tower and of course the Dragon here. So really, really well played from SKT. But also Kuu Tigers investing everything to try and get one kill.
You always know if it takes too long to do something, it's not worth. That's what the Zhonya's is helping to promote for SKT here as they're getting pushed back ever so slowly. But in their pushes, or in, I should say, Kuu's pushes, SKT is able to get more around the map than what Kuu is getting out of the champions of SKT. 11 to 11 in kills. The gold is pretty much tied up here. Just a small lead in what would be probably minions in the lane over to SKT. They have two dragons in their favor, and they haven't let Kuu get very many throughout game one or game two. A lot of control on the map for SKT.
Yeah, and SKT with the Rumble and the Lulu kind of have a double AP composition working, but there's still no Aegis on the side of the Kuu Tigers. And they're not even close to one either, so this is a little bit troubling for Kuu since their split pushing has been getting counter-ganked by AD carries, and their team fighting isn't necessarily itemized for, whereas the power spikes are hitting for SKT with the death cap on the Lulu and the last whisper onto Bang.
You do have your Shen ulti very soon. You have teleport for Smep, so he needs to sit on the bottom side, and the four members from Kuu Tigers has to take over the Baron. They need to control it, because then you get two openings. Either one, you get the one-on-one bot lane with the Shen ulti and your 2v1 kill, obviously on to Marin when he's sitting on the tower. Or, if they try and make a play, you just go on towards and force the Baron, like this.
A lot of miscommunication in that engage. Bang uses both summoners to get himself out with Wild Growth. Gorilla's the focus now on the other side. Prey, he branches off from the team, and here comes Marin on the TP. Zhonya's is down, but he's gonna get gravity fielded. No, he wasted enough time inside that he didn't, but Kuu is able to assess the fight very well, get themselves back in after choosing the right target. Bangy, flag, and drag away. Doesn't look like Kuu has any more priority targets. They lose two, however, in that fight from splitting up so much in the beginning.
Marin teleported in a good 2 or 3 seconds before Smep made his presence known in that team fight, and that's the reason that SKT ends up getting a 2-for-1, because a fight in which Bang gets caught at the beginning should almost never lead to an SKT 2-for-1.
Exactly.
But they do lose the turret afterwards because some nice damage was returned by Kuu Tigers. Really interesting chain of events.
Wolf goes in, Bang shooting somebody else, they still get out alive. However, they can turn situations around so fast to be in their favor and make it work. Still just repairing the lanes now because that wasn't the best of situations they came out of. Coming up on 30 minutes here. These games are definitely going longer than SKT's average, so they have to put a little more effort in to this mid-game area where, as we say, Kuu should be shining.
Sadly for Kuu Tigers, Smep had to use ulti, teleport again. So now he's no longer on the bottom side. You can no longer make that Fiora Shen play very easily because you will lose all your pressure around Baron as he can then start it. So the whole setup for Kuu Tigers with having that 1v1 just keeps getting delayed again and again and again. And Smep really has been struggling to do a whole lot with that early lead he got because he's constantly being put into team fights.
So much of split pushing is about forcing the enemy team into decisions, and half the reason it works is because it's so difficult to coordinate everyone to do exactly the right thing and find the openings. But SKT has been the best team at Worlds this year, as well as having some of the best players, and I think that teamwork is one of the things that's stopping the split push from being so effective, aside from Smev being a little bit slow on the uptake in some of his plays.
And we can't really blame Kuu Tigers for looking at that last fight and saying, oh, we can catch the AD carry, we should go for it. But normally that's not what they wanted to do. They wanted to just have control of the Baron River and wait for Smep to make a play one versus one against Marin. They were gonna wait for him because he was supposed to be the strong member here, the guy who can win his lane consistently, where every time there's a team fight, it's more 50-50 between the teams here. So their safe play was gonna be Smep making a move with Shen ulti. That didn't happen because obviously they saw Bang a little bit out of position, they went for it, but that was basically what SKT wanted. Because now we have this situation again where two top laners are holding each other. It's very difficult for Kuu to make that play because they have no TP. So how do they capitalize?
It's going to be very difficult, especially with Faker having home guard and Whimsy to get himself back out to the lanes. Instantly Glitterlancing, pushing any of Kuu's work back while he was in base. and already down the mid lane. It's not going to be Smeb diving Marn under his turret, so Smeb starts to back off, and Faker was making a roam down, but the movement of Smeb says, I'm in a ward, let's not go for that. Still focused in the mid lane. 1 minute onto Dragon, both teams trying to just pull ultimates, pull flashes or summoner spells out of each other here before it happens.
We're absolutely seeing a game of back and forth right here. Anytime someone leaves to go and push a side lane, you're gonna see a small window of pressure for the opponent. And anytime SKT shows
That's
people
big.
In the mid lane, Smeb will try and go aggressively. End up getting the equalizer out there for very low cost.
97 second cooldown on the equalizer from Marn. That's one of the reasons Rumble is sitting and holding a lane so it can be a bit annoying for him if you have to use ulti due to the long cooldown. This does give an opening for Kutaius. You can see how they're instantly moving in now. Sit around Baron and say, we want to fight now because you have no ulti on your Rumble.
With the distortion enchant for Marn, he has a faster teleport cooldown for Smeb. So even though they used it on the same fight, Marin's teleport's actually up in a couple of seconds right here. And that makes it much less safe for Ku to actually be faking this Baron.
Something we saw him focus in game one. Marn is definitely a huge playmaker on this Rumble. We saw him come from a screen off. Engage in one of the bottom fights. Who's going to start? There's no vision here for SKT.
If SKT goes in, it can actually be a 5v4.
Yeah, this is too risky.
Match teleport. I don't think Ku knows the teleport's up. Now they do.
Marn is going to be coming in. They will not be able to turn and fight this with the damage of Baron in their favor. They just back off completely.
Here's the big window, though, because this time they forced the teleport without forcing the teleport on the other side. So that's a big win for Ku, actually, not overcommitting to the Baron and getting the split push turret. Huge move.
The key thing for Ku Tigers was the fact that Faker had recalled. He was back in base. One other member didn't get to see who was also running from the fountain. So SKT, even though they had five members, they couldn't hide.
They're going back again. They're going back. They have the pink ward, but they do not clear the one in the back of the pit. They are trying to run SKT around the map. And soon, Smeb will have his teleport, but he's drawn Marn up right here. So it's the Rek'Sai, Shen, and the teleport advantage all working in conjunction with the Dragon and Baron being up at once. This is filled with action right
Definitely
now.
Buy the book teleport play, if you will, gentlemen. This would be perfect for Ku to get a giant fight if SKT bunches up in this one. Marn, or Smeb rather, keeping an eye on the team. Marn already had to go back. But the teleport discrepancy actually will not be worked just yet by Ku. We have Hojin going back, but he can ult back in.
And if you're SKT, you have to break this cycle somehow by making an aggressive play or killing one leg of the split push. But at the moment, Ku isn't letting them recover. If anything, this leads to a cataclysmic fight at the Baron pit.
There's no wards behind SKT. There's no real way for Smeb to get a flank. He's just sitting in the lane. He's waiting for SKT to overcommit to a fight, knowing that Rumble isn't there. But you're still at that point where Fiora can duel everyone, so she can safely sit and stay even, at least with Marn, just clear the wave every single time, wait for something. I would want to see a ward from Ku Tigers behind this Baron, so there's a way for Smeb to TP in and get a flank, and he can instantly try and go for bang.
SKT as well, kind of baiting the Baron out. They push down towards
Baron.
Dragon to make sure that Ku goes into it. SKT now approaching. Baron's going to be down to about 4,700 HP. That's the in from Wolf. Stops up three members. Slicing Maelstrom goes down, but it's not really hitting anybody. Stunning the targets it needs. Faker is going to be able to take down Prey. The Baron still stands at 2,300 HP. Smeb is forced to flash out of this one.
That's
is the
Baron.
Fight they were waiting for, but SKT danced it out perfectly. The laser across, it's going to be going to Bengi. SKT gets Baron for a second game in a row, and now they're really going to be able to work the lane.
But what's the point in just teleporting your top laner straight into the Baron pit?
Oh,
that was one kill.
Takes him down.
It's going to be the fight. This is an easy kill for Faker here. Little bit of glitter. Glitter gets everywhere, and it takes down Kuro. 45 seconds on the clock. They're getting longer. Smeb may be able to pick up Dragon, but it's a consolation prize at this point.
Also, when Smeb teleports inside that pit, I think they were trying to do it a little bit undetected, but Marn was able to get an equalizer
in
that pit, which made it dangerous. Bengi Smite is up, so thanks for the help, Smeb.
Thank you very much, says SKT.
Ku Tigers.
It doesn't look like they want to stop either. They see Smeb is low on mana. He's not going to have any potential to fight. Gorilla not doing anything. But you can see how long it's been since they've been in each other's jungles. New wards finally being placed.
Yeah.
Nobody had deep vision before that whole fight.
This obviously completely shuts down the split push here, but Ku Tigers simply got too greedy. They didn't want to wait any longer. They're like, let's just try and burst down the Baron, TP in here with all five guys, and just destroy the Baron as fast as possible before Marn shows up. But now you're just caught in here, so suddenly getting to the AD carry is almost impossible, and he's the guy you want to aim for if you look at what SKT has brought here on the board. So look at Bang, he's just sitting, shooting away all he wants, and they are caught five guys taking damage from Baron at the same time.
Also, the way SKT engaged that fight with Wolf going in with the Unbreakable Will, the Baron was only hitting Koo even though the team fight was taking place in the Baron pit. The dive that Smeb tried to do outwardly maybe would have been best served to just kill frontline to backline. He tried to assassinate through the team of SKT, which is almost never going to work.
Yeah.
Impatience is the word I would use from Koo right there.
It was supposed to be start Baron, four members from SKT move in, TP in behind him, like flash Taunt from the Shen onto Bang and try and destroy him as fast as possible, or maybe the Lulu, and then suddenly you have a good fight going for yourself instead of being caught in that pit. Just a little bit too greedy from Koo Tigers. It cost him in game one, costing him again here in game two.
Smeb not really respecting the members around him. He's just going for a little fight. Damage onto both Bengi and Wolf. Looks like they may want to commit here. They have good vision, but it's being cleared out. Double wards go down. The ward war definitely won by SKT here inside Aku's jungle. And they're so split up, they can't really engage if they want to. A lot being done in defense. Smeb actually puts himself in a spot where he dies. That's a double kill for Bengi. They're not stopping. Bengi jumps over the wall for another kill, and it looks like it's going to be an ace in the base. 22-13 when SKT takes over. They start to steamroll.
And just like that, they still have Baron buff, and Marin's going to grab the minions. He actually still has Equalizer. He uses that to clear the minions. SKT, just like that, it's over.
The game is open for anybody to take. Moments later, SKT wins a few fights, and it is all theirs for the taking. The first Nexus turret goes down here in game two. That's the second one. SK Telecom T1 are one win away from being your two-time world champions.
Another game for SKT where they punish you, they take the Baron, and they walk straight down and finish the game. Nine games so far at Worlds, SKT finished with the Baron buff on them. And Koo Tigers just had the whole setup for such a long time.
And it gets so scary for Koo Tigers now. This was the game where Marin and Bengi made the big mistake early in the game, and then made another mistake by not changing their play style.
This breaks
you. If there was a game to win or get back into the series, it was this one. And Koo needs to prevent being broken by SKT.
We see such a big difference just in shot calling, though, between the teams. The way Koo Tigers are set up in the early game are like, oh, we're winning 1v1 top lane. Fiora is having a great start, a level above the Rumble. Keep playing around. We have the Shen. We picked it early on because we want to split push. And then they keep joining in for fights with this teleport from Fiora, so she loses all her pressure in the mid game. Late game, they have that one opportunity where Rumble had no ulti. They set it up really well. And what do? They greed for the Baron. They rush in, trying to five-man, just take it down as fast as possible. Ends up going completely wrong, and they lose the game. They had so many openings. So many.
Yes, exactly.
I mentioned it in the beginning. You can beat SKT in every facet, but you have to be able to get on their mentality. You have to be able to break them down. And never once in that game did it look like they didn't want to engage. They didn't want to take another fight. They were always going for it.
And so much of this just kind of speaks to the magic of SKT, because we as observers and people watching, we get to see the whole map. And we get to hindsight 2020 all of these decisions. And this is why it's so hard to be SKT. It's not like other teams are even close to being on the level of turning things around, because down in gold, still win. Usually up in gold, making the right decisions time and time and time again. One game away from being the first team to win two world championships.
Absolutely crazy. We're going to go ahead and throw it over to our analyst desk to see what they make of that decisive SKT win.
Thank you, Riv. Still undefeated for SKT there. Although it
looked that was the game.
That's the thing. It didn't look good there after those few early plays.
How can you lose faith, Monty?
But how dare you, Monty? Yeah, but you know the thing is Jat said it. That was the game to win there for Koo. Things only get more terrifying from this point onward when you see yourself set up, literally set up within the first 2.5 minutes of a game for victory, and then it slips away from you.
Yeah, I mean, we kept talking about Koo's punish game and how they're waiting for all these mistakes to happen, and then they punish you so hard, and they're able to. The mistakes came too early in the game, maybe, and they didn't know what to quite do with an early lead, because it looked like, while yes, Marin and Bengi were making a lot of early errors, and they were, you know, sort of tilting themselves. Smeb also, then he kind of took that and went too aggressive. They were overreaching in a lot of places, and SKT slowly built their lead back up from these small skirmishes across the map.
Yeah, zeroing in on those first two instances in which Koo got their lead, Krepo, I'm coming to you, because the team comps, the way that they were set up, we would have looked at SKT's and said, well, this is a Koo comp. You know, we're going to just stall out the game and wait for it. And Ku's comp is one that is looking to snowball, set up that split push as Kobe mentioned. So those early kills that we got in those first two plays with the missteps from SKT, you would have thought, well, is Ku going to be able to have the tools to do what SKT would have done with that lead?
Yeah, they just changed the entire dynamic of the early game. And the way that happened there, exactly this phase right here, where just greed from SKT going way too deep here for that initial dive, that put them behind so much. And then the game kind of turned around. So SKT was kind of playing a Ku style. Now they were playing from behind. They were the ones baiting the dives, trying to punish the dives. And you would think a team that is so good at the whole anti-dive game like Ku Tigers would actually prevent that later on. And this entire phase here where you see Marn flashing for the kill, it just, that never works out. Even if you like get that, it's just too greedy.
Yeah, it's incredibly high risk, and the dives just keep coming. They punish the flashless state of Marn over and over and over again. Just try and put him as much
and Bengi
as possible, and then Bengi decides to show up.
Oh, how did I get here?
For some reason.
And a new challenger approaches.
Bengi really wants his repeat world championship, too.
Yeah, they do. Guys. He picks up the one kill. Gorilla, unfortunately, taking the aggro.
Once he was under the tower, he did play that well. Like, he knew they were about to launch another auto attack, so he wanted to give them tower aggro with a double knockup. Like, trying to get out of these sticky situations, they did do their best, but just don't get in those situations. That's the one thing. Like, why get there? You know, such a smart team. But later on, SKT, they did pick up the pace, and they showed some fantastic macro play overall.
Absolutely.
This is why we just point out there's so many threats on SKT. Even if, you know, jungler and top laner, the two biggest playmakers on your team, having a terrible early game, there's still Faker and Bang there to carry you.
Now, before we get into those plays in which SKT was able to claw their lead back, I do want to dissect the reason why Ku wasn't able to press their advantage as hard as they could. We saw till very late in the game, no dragons taken, and then the first one was taken by SKT. With what Ku had at their disposal, you would have expected them to set up around that objective.
I mean, it is a little hard because you're going up against Jarvan Rumble, which has one of the best ult combos in the game, so it can be still very dangerous to fight in the mid game, even if you're ahead around an objective like dragon, as opposed to just split pushing. We're gonna see that replay right here. I mean, they just turn Hojin, Whimsium right at the beginning.
Yeah, but this is what I love so much about watching SKT play. Any other team here, they work in 30-second intervals. They look at plays and they say, what can we get in the next 30 seconds? SKT, they plan a minute or a minute and a half ahead, because as we see right here, many teams would go 5-man mid to try and not lose their tier 2. SKT, they know they can defend 4-man, banks all the way in the bottom. But then usually teams will yield this red pressure and they still go for the fight here. They know Smeb doesn't have flash from earlier, so they even force here the combo to make him stand on the ultimate from Rumble here. So really good plays by SKT. And meanwhile, in the bot lane, Bang is still pushing.
Yeah, and if you keep up that macro pressure, it's obviously huge. Smeb did a good job of riposting at the beginning of that fight, the knockup from Bengi, but with the ultimate following right after, there still wasn't that much to be done. And they really did punish when they saw them going into the top side, and Bang's just sitting here, free shooting at a turret.
And that is one of their strengths. SKT, when they're down a member in a team fight or down a member on a map play, they will not yield the area, not the pressure. They will keep fighting it. They can win 4v5s if they have the preferential engage. And right there, they noticed that, well, we can slow them down enough for Bang to, worst case, take two towers in the bot lane for free. And that was such a smart call, because in the heat of the moment to make that call, there's so many teams that will just go 5 mid and just panic.
But they know that that's a power spike, right, that they have. Going into that particular phase in the game, especially in a choke against a Fiora like that. So it's not only knowing when, like, or how to take these fights, it's when to take these fights, even if they're behind. They say, okay, we still have higher power in this situation. And the speed at which they can dissect that and know that is incredible.
Yeah, Ku on your screen there probably discussing some of the communication failures that they had as a team. And I want to point towards that dragon dance that we saw, Kobe, because, again, they had shown the pushing power, split pushing power of Fiora. They finally got her into a side lane against a TP-less Marin, and yet they chose to start a fight.
Not only did they have the split pushing Fiora that got a lead in the early game, they also had a support Shen who has global. They also had a jungle Rek'Sai who has a global, another role that you don't usually have a global from. So they had all of these tools to try and push an early lead and do the style that SKT usually use, where they pressure multiple points on the map at the same time and then pick you off. But they were unable to accomplish it. We also saw that in the Baron baits, when they had that teleport discrepancy you talk about with Marn. They had teleport advantage. They spent so long trying with the Baron bait over and over, trying to work with the Trucite. And they finally pulled the trigger by actually teleporting him into the Baron and losing it. That was just complete disaster. So this team really, they need to completely restart after this game, because they've got to be a bit dejected after that, and they just need to look at it as a fresh start.
I mean, the most disappointing thing about that Baron Dance was they had executed it so well for a few minutes in a row, and then they just decide to commit to it instead of continuing to put that inhibitor pressure down or waiting for SKT, because they definitely were dictating the tempo at that specific point in time.
All right, well, with that win, SKT are just one win away from an undefeated world run and the Summoner's Cup, so don't go anywhere. We'll see if Ku can come back in game three in just a few minutes.
In Berlin, Championship Finals.
Oh, Baggy! Level one turret dive! Baggy definitely messed that up!
Quite quickly.
It's Hogan.
Oh, the kill though. Smev. He makes it. Grand Challenge is down, so this is all about Smev's abilities. Gorilla goes in the middle of the fight with a nice flash.
And back,
Gorilla goes down. Here comes Kuro. Throws down the Chaos Storm. It's all over Wolf, though.
Faker just completely turned this game.
That's the end from Wolf. Stops up three members. Slicing Maelstrom goes down, but it's not really hitting anybody or stunning the targets it needs. That's a double kill for Bangi. They're not stopping. Bang jumps over the wall for another kill, and it looks like it's going to be an ace in the base. SK Telecom T1 are one win away from being your two-time world champions.